quickly going to pull out some of the elements of this story structure. Follows the standard process. Lots going on in this story, actually, so I'm just going to focus on one or two of the elements. Let's go over basic story architecture first. So when you first start writing and filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon you realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending as state of perfection, which is lost becomes state of imperfection, the lost phase, the limitations phase, and the process of returning to it is undergone. You can start there, or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events there tend to be referenced to later stages, as in this story. Most stories, such as this one, end with some form of state of perfection. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost irrelevant. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, transmogrification, psychological journey, the various arcs, transmogrification. You're always going to have physical journey, and you're always moving through new worlds, which really are physical manifestations of new psychological states and versions of the self. Working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops. Each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which may be communicated, they tell you what tangibles or intangibles you're going in there to acquire, how to construct those sequences. So for example, if that's the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, repression, fear of exit, etc. So those sub-stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you are here, you're not able to return, so you have to go forward, grow, learn, mature, let go of your older limitations, versions of yourself, etc., come all the way around until you're ready to return. So that's basic story architecture, the fundamental framework that all successful stories are based around. I go over that in great detail in the 2100 stage of journey, transformation, movement through new worlds and states, which you can purchase off the website. So let's get rid of that and let's draw another loop so we know now there's much more behind that than a simple circle would suggest. So we kick into it in the imperfect state, the lost phase, the limitations phase, and we've got Captain Phillips and he's leaving home, so that's classic. And we see him looking at a map, so we've got this idea that we're going on this journey. And then there's this conversation that takes place between him and his wife in the car, and that's actually quite important. So he's saying that things are changing, they're not as they used to be, they're not as easy as they used to be, he's worried for his kids, things are getting a lot harder, you've got to be tough out there to survive. So he's referencing the state of affection lost. And also later on, Muse talks about how he was a fisherman, but then the rich countries came, took all the fish, and now there's no fish left. So damage done, paradise lost, all referenced throughout the story. So a number of things mentioned in his conversation with his wife. His wife says, are you alright? We'll be alright, won't we? And then she holds him, and there's this idea that if we stick together, we'll be alright. And Captain Phillips does say that also, just beyond the physical separation. He says, if we stick together, we'll be alright. So that's one of the messages that underpins the story. And you hear that throughout, this idea that it'll be alright. He also says, for example, that you've got to be tough to survive. You hear that throughout. He says, 50 men looking for the one job now. And when we go and meet the Somalis, that's exactly what's happening. We've got 50 guys looking for the one job. So in that scene where we meet the Somalis, also there's the boy and there's the reference to his sister. Where is she? And so in essence, there's another message in there, which is that you don't have to be a pirate and kidnap people. You don't have to make this choice. There are other choices available. And the leader of the Somalis, the pirate, says, why aren't you working? And that's another message woven in. We've got Captain Phillips is very focused on his work. So is Muse, by the way. We've got that initial sequence with the crew who aren't as focused on their work. So one of the messages is that if we work and we make the right choices and we stick together, then we'll be all right. So then we leave, the Somalis leave, we've got Muse leaving, and immediately we've got his competitor, the other boat captain, saying, don't talk to me. So already they're representing the anti-message, which is they're not sticking together, and so they won't be all right. So when we get into the lifeboat, you're going to have this process where you've got the crew and the U.S. Navy, etc., or everybody on Captain Phillips' side sticking together, and in the end they are all right. And the opposite of that is the Somalis, the pirates. They aren't sticking together, and the result of that is that they won't be all right. So then we go out, and we have Captain Phillips arriving in Oman at the Maersk on his boat. The crew are lazy. They're sitting about in the mess hall. They're drinking coffee, and he gets them to work and gets them working together and pulls them towards his side of the message. We've also got this idea of the fear and unwillingness. So we've got this warning that there may be pirates along the Somali coast, and the unwillingness represented through him doing the security checks off embarking on this psychological journey. We know we're going to go on this physical journey, but not really prepared for the psychological journey that will be the results of the pirates invading. So then we go in essence to the first threshold, and that is the first two skiffs that they try and catch the Maersk, and the anti-message displayed when one of them breaks away. So again, they're not sticking together. And for the first threshold separation from Musée's point of view, or the pirate's point of view, is when Musée knocks out the other captain, takes his engine, and again, they're not sticking together. So that's when, in essence, the pirates halve in number. So what we have is, in essence, a separation arc where they increasingly decrease in number until the apotheosis, when you've just got Musée leading on his own. And from Captain Phillips' point of view, the crew sit down. Some of them want to go back, but there is no going back, so that's expressed in that scene. And also, he gets them working together on side, reinforcing this message that if we stick together, we'll get through it. So then we go forward. In essence, the physical separation is Musée turning up with his lone skiff, trying to board. That's the physical separation. We resist that, so we have the water cannons, we have the flares. We don't want it to happen, but obviously he boards, and that's in essence our physical separation. And now what we have is the crew sticking together, and they've shut the boat down, and we need, Musée needs to find the crew, and he puts a gun to the head of one of the crew, and that situation has got over. That crew member survives because Captain Phillips is sticking with him. And everything's all right. Also relating to the idea of choices, he's all right because Musée is making the choice. In other words, he's starting to make the right choices. And then we've got Musée wanting to find the crew, so that takes us onto our road of trials. And we've got our innocent archetype. The boy is injured and he's sent upstairs, and we've got Musée on his own hunting for the crew. The crew, by the way, is sticking together, making sure that nobody can get or start the boat up. And it's because he's on his own, it's because he hasn't stuck with them, that when he finds them, he's captured and then he's forced off. So exiting the road of trials is when he's forced onto the lifeboat. And Captain Phillips at that point also doesn't stick with his crew, goes down into the lifeboat, and that's why it's not all right, and that's why he's kidnapped. And then we have this process going all the way along, where in essence you've got, you've got three characters. You've got one, two, three. So you've got Phillips on one side, and you've got Bilal on the other. And they're both on message in that they are sticking together. Bilal's sticking with his team, and Phillips, is acting like a kind of supernatural aid towards Musée, and pulling him onto his side, so pulling him onto the side of the right choices. So that's the basis of the conflict there. And at the same time, you see them off message, or the anti-message, so they're not sticking together. So you've got Musée phoning his boss, but it can't reach his boss, and then when he does, his boss just lets him go, doesn't stick with him. This is the opposite of the Phillips and the crew. When Phillips is taken on the lifeboat, we've got the ship following, sticking with them, and then we've got the Navy turning up, and we don't have one boat, we have two, and then ultimately three, so all symbolizing that we're sticking together, and if we stick together, we'll be all right. And then moving forward, you've got our rebirth or baptism symbolism, so that's Phillips. He wants to go for a piss, and he jumps in the water, so he's submerged. We've got a near-death experience, and interestingly, it's our antagonistic function that's wants to kill us. So that's Bilal that's trying to kill Captain Phillips. All the way around until we've got our atonement, so with the father, with the parents, so the elders have turned up. The boon, the intangible boon is Captain Phillips saying, you're not just a pirate, so you can be somebody else, you can make another choice. So relating to everything that we've been presented with here. And then the physical apotheosis is literally leaving, and leaving, when Muse leaves, what he does is he separates. He's not sticking with his, he's not sticking together with the pirates. He separates on his own, and that's what results in him not being alone. Then you've got this move towards the final conflict. So in essence, you've got Phillips breaking the rules, writing a letter, and actually, when he does that, you see that the innocent, the boy, is on his side, and in essence, what that provokes is the character that's playing our antagonistic function, bringing him into direct conflict. So that's the fight at the end between Bilal and Phillips, and that's what causes the Navy to essentially fire and take out the pirates. So in the end, the final conflict is between two sides, one side sticking together and the other side not sticking together. And the State of Perfection has returned, so we're back, in essence, back home in the med lab. We're being taken care of. And the last bit of dialogue that the nurse says is, it'll be alright. So that ends it. So there's quite a lot going on. I've tried to just stick to this one message of if we stick together, it'll be all right. How that's woven through, even though structurally it's all the same. You've got the near-death experience, the physical separation, the first threshold, the rota trial, etc. So that's a very basic deconstruction of that story. If you want a detailed deconstruction, you can order it off a website, off our website. But I do these deconstructions to show that all these stories follow this process of journey and transformation and movement through new worlds and states, which, as I said, I go over in the 2100 stage, Hero's Journey, Transformation, Movement through New Worlds and States, which you can purchase off the website.